The Communist Party of the Philippines is celebrating its 54th anniversary today, December 26. The group earlier ruled out a holiday ceasefire with state forces, even as it mourns the death of its founder, Jose Maria Sison. To talk more about this, we are joined by Colonel Medel Aguilar, spokesperson of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Colonel Aguilar, Merry Christmas and welcome back to the program.
Merry Christmas din po, Attorney Mike and Ms. Nikki and to all our viewers.
All right, first off, Colonel, how was the situation over the weekend? Were there any reported incidents, clashes, or skirmishes given that there's no ceasefire in place?
There was no violence. There was no reported atrocities, offensive conducted by the CPP and PA. In fact, what happened during the past week is more on surrender of CTG personalities, CPP and PA and members from different parts of the country in Zamboanga del Sur, in Sorsogon area. And most of these are facilitated by local government units. So we had a very peaceful celebration of the Christmas. And we supported the PNP in the kind of law enforcement operation so that there will be peace and order in our communities.
Colonel, may we know how many surrendered over the weekend? And what were the reasons given by those who surrendered?
The reasons the surrender is actually still undergoing debriefing. So we will know more about the reason of their surrender. But what is evident right now is that there is a breakdown of communication from the national leadership down to the subordinate organs of the CPP, making them at least giving them the opportunity to surrender because there is no longer that strong restraint on the part of the CPP to hold them.
Do we have a figure, sir? How many surrendered?
Yes, we have 11 right now in Sorsogon. And some are listed, some are not. And we are happy to receive them, especially it happened during the Christmas Day, 25 December.
All right. Now, Colonel, today marks the 54th founding anniversary of the Communist Party of the Philippines. Are you anticipating any possible attacks or any form of movement on the part of the CPP and PA to mark this occasion?
So far, we have not received any information indicating a possible attack coming from the CPP and the NDF. But just the same, we will not lower our guard so that we can react or we can defend the communities from any of these attacks. We have seen the significant reduction in their capabilities. Of course, we have neutralized many of the leaders, first Junius Giron in 2020, and then later on by Menandro Villanueva, alias Bok, George Madlos, and even their supposedly chairman, acting chairman today, Benito Champson, is still nowhere to be found. So his long silence is actually creating a leadership vacuum in the CPP leadership. That's what we would like to take advantage of because this is an opportunity for us in government to reach out to their subordinate leaders so that we can engage them in a localized peace initiative, peace talks.
Before we talk about the leadership vacuum they're mentioning, Colonel, how big is an organization is the CPP-NP as of the moment? Because you have AFP Chief of Staff Lieutenant General Bartolome Vicente Bacaro saying that there are now only 24 guerrilla fronts from 89 previously. But the CPP yesterday came out with a statement saying they have established 110 communist guerrilla fronts in the past 5 decades. So what's the real score? How many communist guerrilla fronts are we still talking about?
When you go down to the field, you will find out that there only exists around 23 guerrilla fronts. That's what they can put up right now. And out of this figure, only 5 are active. Meaning these are the guerrilla fronts that can actually implement party programs. The others, 18, are weakened. And if we are able to sustain our operations, military, and at the same time, the civic actions or the civic works that has to be implemented to address the root cause of insurgency, then probably we can already expect that these guerrilla fronts, these 18 guerrilla fronts, will just lose its relevance and die a natural cause. So as far as the strength of the CPP NPA and DF, the last time that we had our validation, that was in the third quarter of this year, there were just around 2,112 active members of the CPP NPA. Now, this number has gone down already because every day we receive reports of neutralization, surrender, etc. And so the figure now is, lower. So we can expect also that in the coming days, when we conduct our validation, it will be much lower than the reported figure.
And how many weapons are they wielding, Colonel? Do you have an idea?
Yes, we have also received report that they only have around 1,800 plus firearms that they can use to conduct offensive actions.
You mentioned five active communist guerrilla fronts. Where are these areas? And when you say active, does that mean they can actually wage attacks on the AFP?
Okay, the five active guerrilla fronts, four of them are located in Samar and one in Mindanao. Now, when we say active, it means that they still have about strength, but they are no longer that capable of conducting large-scale offensive action against the government. So what they can do are just harassments, which actually in a kind of engagement that they conduct, which is away from the targets. Most of them are soft targets, as they call it. So these are not actually much of a threat for us to be concerned of. So what we are doing right now is focus our capabilities to the five remaining active guerrilla fronts. Now, these active guerrilla fronts are the ones that can conduct, can implement party programs. Say, for example, in Samar, they are still in the communities. Some of them are organizing peasants, mostly farmers, so that they can recruit new members that will join the New People's Army.
Mm-hmm. Now, Colonel, let's talk about the leadership vacuum that you were referring to. Do we have an idea now as to who could possibly replace Joma Sison as head of the CPP? There were at least four names that were floated. For instance, the wife of Joma Sison, Julieta Sison. Then there is also Luis Alandoni, the former chief negotiator of the National Democratic Front of the Philippines. And then alleged communist leaders Benito and Wilma Tiamson. But you did mention earlier the possible neutralization of the Tiamsons. But can you confirm if these names are actually what you're looking at as possible next leaders of the CPP-NPA?
When Professor Jose Maria Sison died December 17, he was no longer in the leadership of the CPP hierarchy. Marco Balbuena said that he is their teacher and their guiding light. Now, that means that he no longer have direct authority over the party organs, subordinate party organs, and even to the New People's Army. Now, he is irreplaceable in the sense that he is the ideological leader of the CPP, and that there is no person or remaining in the organization that has the same quality as Joma. Now, Luis Alandoni said that he will also be a senior consultant of the NDFP when the peace talk resumes. So there is no replacement for Joma. But as to the chairmanship of the CPP, which is actually the actual leadership in the Communist Party of the Philippines, of course, there are many names that came out. But Benito Tiamson, who is supposed to be on top after the neutralization of Julius Giron, Minandro Villanueva, George Madlos. But the problem with Benito Tiamson is that he is nowhere to be found. He has been very silent, and therefore that leaves now this the Central Committee of the CPP leadership to impress upon everybody that the Central Committee is still there, and that through the press statements that they come up with, they are able to communicate to their subordinate organs the messages and the directives that they want to convey. Now, it's a good thing that even after the declaration that the NPA can conduct tactical offensive while mourning for the death of Joma, none of this happened because evidently there is already a leadership vacuum, a crisis in the organization that leaves a breakdown in communication line between the national organs and down to the local subordinate organs of the CPP NPA.
Colonel, let's talk about the Tamzons. Would you have conclusive confirmation at this point that, that they were killed in Samar in August, as previously reported? You said there are indicators, but to what extent have you actually tried to uncover if they were indeed killed in that encounter in Samar in August?
We believe that the CPP are already conducting some kind of a tracing, tracking of the whereabouts of Joma from the of the Tamson couple from the last time and the last place they were seen. And they are also mobilized the relatives to look for the body of these two supposedly leaders of the CPP and NPA. Now, we cannot say conclusively that they are dead because we need body of evidence to prove that they are really dead. So we just leave it that, at that, so that because we cannot produce the body. So, but there is actually that leadership problem. They were supposed to take the lead now, but just as what I have said a while ago, they are nowhere to be found.
Mm-hmm. Now, in our previous interview, Colonel, you said that the CPP NPA without Joma will feel directionless and lost. But in its statement yesterday, the CCP said Joma lives on. And may I quote, his immortal revolutionary spirit will forever live to guide the next generation of party cadres to greater heights, the statement said. Your thoughts on this?
First, as Joma is irreplaceable, no one can take his place. So his death actually will impact on the cohesion of the organization. Some of the researches that Joma conducted way back in the 1960s are no longer present, especially the socio-economic situation. So while his ideology will remain, his research or his study before will remain, but this will not no longer be effective in today's society because we have seen a lot of changes already happening. And that makes the study of Joma no longer very effective in convincing people and organizing people against the government. Now, the lack of Joma is actually an opportunity for us, for all of us in the government to reach out to local leaders of the CPP-NPA because what we want to achieve is the settlement of the issues, the socioeconomic issues that people confront in their daily lives in the communities through the whole of nation approach involving the communities, the local chief executives, the security forces, and even the members of the party or those the members of the mass organizations that they have put up in every community. We want an immediate solution to this problem so that there will be no longer problem in our communities.
You don't think, Colonel, that the problems of inequality, the lack of jobs, inflation, even human rights abuses, these are the same problems that we're still facing now, and these are the problems that they were raising a few decades ago?
First, the supposedly propaganda about human rights abuses, these are not happening anymore. In the military, we have that human rights office, now the Center for Law of Armed Conflict, to make sure that all our programs, all our operation plans, and all our actions are in adherence to international humanitarian law and respecting human rights. Now, on the socio-economic issues, I think these are already being addressed by the different government agencies. That's why we have a whole of nation approach in dealing with, not just with insurgency, but other forms of violent extremism that we face every day. So we trust the civil government that it is capable of performing its mandate so that the people will no longer be agitated and organized against the government.
You mentioned human rights violations are no longer happening, Colonel, but there are some reports of reported harassment and arrest of alleged members of the Communist Party of the Philippines, and you have some cases actually reaching the courts, and the courts saying there's no basis to arrest them. So in your view, these are not human rights violations?
We cannot talk about when you talk about the courts throwing out the cases because of some probably insufficiency of evidence to prove the case against a person. But we believe that we are doing our job because we, aside from the intelligence, aside from the evidences that you have, we also have intelligence reports that about the membership of certain individuals to the underground organization movement. Now, this may not be enough to put the person behind bars, but what is important for us is that we know them, that they belong to this organization, and hopefully that one day they will realize that joining this underground movement is no longer beneficial to the Filipino people, because as I've said, you cannot correct a mistake by doing another mistake, which is clinging to the armed struggle as a way to effect changes in our society. Now, some of the reported, if you go to the Commission on Human Rights, I think you cannot find a single case against the AFP there on alleged violation of human rights. Right now, we have a zero. As far as I know, we don't have a report now at the CHR against military personnel involved in human rights violations.
You have several cases or petitions before the Supreme Court, a writ of amparo petitions, Colonel, and some of them were granted, and writ of amparo, by their nature, they're protection against violations of human rights. What do you say to that?
Yeah, of course, when a person petitioned the Supreme Court for a writ of amparo, it's a way to protect them, to give them extra protection on the premise that their lives are in danger. But it doesn't mean that we are involved in any human rights violation. That is just the side of the petitioner. And of course, there is a process that is involved that will require us to present our side also. So it's not a case of human rights violation per se, but a protection given to an individual who thinks that his life is in danger.
Mm-hmm. Let me move on to another topic, Colonel. How significant is it for you that in its statement, the CPP acknowledged that it suffered losses and setbacks in various fields of revolutionary work resulting from subjectivism, internal weaknesses, and errors, but it said they are determined to rectify these errors. It also expressed confidence it will gain unprecedented strength moving forward. Your reaction to that statement by the CPP?
The subjective condition right now is different from the condition way back in 1969 or 1968 when the party was established, and in 1992 when there was this rectification movement. Mm-hmm. It's different now. Therefore, the elements that will make their rectification now are no longer there for the party to be able to resurrect, or shall we say, rebound from their setbacks. And I think what is important right now is that we have the masses, the people on our side, to help us to make sure that we can address issues that they are exploiting against the government.
Mm-hmm. And Colonel, the CPP-NPA insurgency is being touted the longest running rebellion in Asia. What do you think it will take to achieve peace?
The longest insurgency is stubbornness on their part. And for them to think that they will still achieve their ultimate goal of overthrowing the government, seizing political power, is already insanity. And their insistence to survive, to remain, is a kind of selfishness on their part. Because what I believe is that it's not the ideology anymore, but more of the benefits that they derive from the underground movement because of the resources they generate, either domestically or from abroad. Now, I think this communist insurgency can be addressed already if only all of us will work together so that we can address the issues. Sir, this is also my call to everybody in the Philippines, in our people, to all our citizenry, that we have to work together if we want to come to end communist insurgency, because this is already the most opportune time that we are waiting for, so that we can end this 54 years of communist insurgency.
All right. On that note, Colonel Medel Aguilar, spokesperson of the Armed Forces of the Philippines, thank you so much for joining us again this morning.
Thank you, sir, Mike and Ms. Nikki, and may I express our profound greetings to all our people, to the Filipino people, of Merry Christmas and Advance Happy New Year. Thank you for this opportunity. Good morning.
Thank you, Colonel.